Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living. It is our hope that you will be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. Many years ago, blacksmiths discovered that melting iron and other materials in a crucible produced steel that was superior to other metals. The swords made from this refining process were stronger, more flexible, and held an edge better than their counterparts. As you begin to grow in Christ, God too will deal with you, and that refining process can be painful. Contrary to popular belief, Christianity is not about feeling good. There will be mountaintop experiences and times in the valley of despair, but the Lord will use these negative circumstances to form your character. Trials may result from poor decisions or through no fault of your own. Nevertheless, there is nothing that happens unless God allows it. The Lord is looking for people who are willing to listen for His voice and to follow through with obedience. If you're resisting God, it is easier to line up with His program than to be a fool who thinks He is more powerful than the Creator. This message is entitled, Living in the Crucible. I would invite you to turn to the book of Philippians, chapter 1. Verse 6, that's where we're going to start off the message today. And when you stand in the bathroom every single morning and you look in the mirror, are you happy with the person that you see staring back at you? I've heard testimony of unsaved people where they share how they are successful in life, of when they say to themselves, well, I've not been happy with what I've been looking at for the last 2 weeks. It's time for a change. They recognize that. And the definition of insanity could simply be described as doing the same thing and failing and keep doing the same thing and failing over and over again and somehow expecting a different result. When it comes to the kingdom of God, We need to re-examine ourselves. And as I discussed last week, we need to ask God to help us to see ourselves as God sees us. Yes, we see ourselves every single day, but do we see ourselves as God truly sees us? And we say, oh, I'm a good person. Really? You think you're a good person? If you were to go and ask God, would He say that you're a good person right now? That is one of the basic tenets of when we share salvation with people, is because people generally think of themselves as, I'm just a good person. I give money to the poor. I donate my time. I'm involved in this and that. I'm a good person. Yes. When we judge ourselves, are we judging by a righteous standard? And in facing the problems that we have, are we looking at them through our eyes, or are we looking at them through God's eyes? And it's two different viewpoints. Again, we're used to being this. And I had shared last week, we want to look at it from a slightly different angle. Because when we see that, it changes our perspective. Growing in Christ means that there is a refining process. We're not perfect. And God said, I'll take you just the way that you are. I think you're perfect just the way you are. And I'm going to take you, and then I'm going to begin molding you into the person that I want you to be. The person that when I thought of you in time back, okay, He thought of all of us in time back. And when He came up with the idea of who we would be, our emotional makeup, our desires, our physical stature and everything, He knew what our potential was. But are we living up to that? And so as we come to Christ, are we then living up to this potential? And if we're not, He's going to take steps that ensures that we're moving in that direction. And that refining process sometimes is extremely painful. However, it's important to note, as we're going to read here in Philippians chapter 1, that God will not abandon us. The situation might look bleak, but God has not abandoned us. In Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6, Paul says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." That is basically Paul saying, you have this check, this cashier's check. It's good. It's guaranteed. And you can cash that at any time, and you can go to God, and it's never going to be where God's going to say, "I'm sorry, I don't have time for you. I'm sorry, I'm distracted at the moment. I'm sorry, I'm angry and irritated with you. Come back some other day." These human emotions that we have, many times we try and attribute things to God that are not necessarily true. But once God has begun something in us, it's not like he ever lets go. He maintains that level of control whether we realize it or not. And Paul is saying here that he that has begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Well, when is the day of Jesus Christ? Well, the day of Jesus Christ is A, when you graduate from this earth through death, or Jesus comes back. Now, more than likely, I would say you're going to die much sooner than that, because there are certain biblical events that Jesus is not necessarily coming back right away like tomorrow. We don't see the world events happening yet. But the day of Jesus Christ is when you, I don't really prefer to say death. I prefer graduation day. It's when your time on earth is done. And you know, Hudson Taylor had a quote when he said, he was this missionary to China, and he said, "You know, the devil should be holding a feast on the day that you die," saying, more or less, you know, "Thank God that person is out of here. I don't have to deal with them anymore." We should be such a terror to the devil that when we leave, he holds a feast of thanksgiving to say, "I'm glad that person is gone." But that is the day of Jesus Christ, when we graduate or when Jesus comes back. Now, Christianity is not about feeling good all the time. There are going to be days where you feel fantastic and you're having these mountaintop experiences where life is great. You're not having any problems. You don't have any complaints. Everything is going great. And you feel the presence of the Lord. Now, sometimes when we're in church, we gather together, you know, there's a definite feeling that you have, and you take that home with you. It sustains you throughout the week. It's there when you wake up. It's there when you go to bed. It's there with you throughout your whole day. And life is fantastic. And honestly, who, when you're living in that manner, who wants it to end? And yet there's going to be times where we begin to dip down. And there's going to be low times in our life. There's going to be trials that come across. And these trials will bring sorrow. They're going to bring pain, an affliction into our life. And the question is then, what are we doing when we enter into those low points? Because it's real easy to live on the mountaintop. There's no problems. I mean, for all intents and purposes, Adam and Eve, when they lived in the Garden of Eden, they were living on the mountaintop. There was never any valleys for them. They did not enter a valley until they chose to sin. And from there on, their life is very much the same as ours today. They had highs, they had lows. But before they chose to sin, it was just nothing but mountaintops. Well, reality is that sin is here. Okay, we have to deal with that. So what are we going to do? Now, in the book of Job, chapter 13, we have an example of, I tell you what, if Job didn't have very good friends, and if you had friends like Job, you might want to tell them to get lost. Because these three friends of his, they didn't offer him good advice, they didn't have words of encouragement, and
they were just coming in and they were hitting him. They were basically messengers of the devil. And Job makes a couple statements. He makes a statement in chapter 13 and verse 15, and he says, this is now at one of the lowest points in his life. He says, though he, this is speaking of God, slay me, yet will I trust in him. Though he slay me, yet I will trust in him. It seemed like God was against him at that point. But Job was declaring his faith and saying, I don't necessarily understand what's happening here right now, but I'm going to trust in God, even if it kills me. And if you flip over to chapter 19 and verse 25, he says, for I know that my Redeemer lives, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. This is a profound statement, because, you know, we can look back and we have this benefit of hindsight when it comes to the biblical stories. We knew what happened before with Job. We go with him along, and we can also skip ahead in this, and we can see what the final outcome is. And when it comes to living and being, you know, authentic Christianity, living in the moment, we don't have the benefit of looking forward into the future. Job didn't have that benefit. We know what happened to him, but he didn't have that benefit. So this then, you know, in facing our problems, Job was living in this crucible. And a crucible is a refining process when it comes to metal. Now, you have something called Damascus steel or crucible steel, and going back 400 or 500 years ago and even further back, it was a big deal. It was kind of like a secret weapon. And it came down to that if you had two guys fighting with swords, and one guy was fighting with an iron sword, and one guy was fighting with crucible steel, and swords will inevitably clash, okay? The crucible steel sword could break the iron sword. Even, you know, the man who was wielding it, he may not have been a superior warrior, but he would simply win because he had a better weapon than the other guy. And the point being is that crucible steel now was not easy to make. It comes from basically a container that you put, and you put iron in, and you put carbon in, you put different ingredients in, and you bake it. And you heat it up in the fire, intense amount of heat. And when I say living in the crucible, Job was living in this crucible. It was intense. It was unbearable at times. And as he's sitting here, and he's not sure what to do, and yet he was still able to say, though God slay me, I will still trust him. A huge statement of faith. Job didn't realize it, but God was developing what I'm going to call his character quotient, his CQ. Now, we've all heard of IQ. You know, what is your IQ score, or what is your intelligent quotient? Someone was to say, well, I have a very high IQ. I'm extremely smart. And so we have a scale, right? We have people that are retarded, that are at a certain level, and you have what we call, I don't know, normal people, and then you have people that are high IQ. Generally, they have an easier time of memorizing things and so forth. But God is not necessarily interested in you having an extremely high IQ if your character quotient is totally deficient. God is interested in developing our character. That is what he was developing with Job. Now, I heard a story of a boy that was retarded. And he was at some type of summer camp. And the other boys had, basically started making fun of him. somebody shared the gospel with him. He understood the gospel, and he became born again. And he began running around the camp, simply yelling, "Good news!" and repeating it over and over again. And when the boys stopped him and they said, "What are you yelling about?" And he said, "God loves me." This was a revelation that God had given to him at his level that he could understand. It didn't matter that his IQ was extremely low. It was his character, it was his soul that was valuable in God's eyes. And from that point on, even if God never healed his mind, his character is what was going to be developed over time. When it comes to the Christian life, it's our character that God is interested in. We could be one of the smartest persons out there and fail extremely low at a moral level. The character quotient is essentially at the level at which you will compromise your integrity. Now, I've always said that if I was going to compromise my integrity, I would hope that I would at least sell myself out for something, and it wouldn't be meaningless, like for $50. If you were going to offer me $5 billion, I would seriously consider it, because that's a lot of money. But would I sell out? Would I compromise my integrity? That is what God is looking for here, is that CQ, that character quotient, when he says, "Who are you and who am I going to develop you into?" God is willing to do whatever it takes to make us more like Jesus. That's really what it comes down to. Flip over to Hebrews chapter 12. And we will examine that. Now, in Hebrews chapter 12 here, the Apostle Paul is discussing something that is not necessarily popular. It's not my favorite subject, I can tell you that. It's basically God chastising us as needed. Now, I don't chastise my children because I enjoy it. I chastise my children because I'm trying to build their character. I'm trying to form them and mold them into the person that I know that God wants them to be. And I'm trying to basically give them a start so that when I push them out later on in life, they're running and they're running with the Lord. If I can do that as a parent, I've done my job. But my job as a parent doesn't end. I mean, I'm still with them, but they're now running on their own. Now, if you were to ask any of my children, "Do you enjoy getting punished?" Of course the answer is no. No one enjoys being punished. If you were to ask yourself, "Do I enjoy, when I break God's commandments and he basically has to deal with me in a negative manner?" No, I don't enjoy that. And yet it happens. In verse 5, Paul says, "And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks unto you as unto children. My son, despise not you the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when you are rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and scourges every one whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chastens not?" In other words, in verse 7, a father that is remiss in chastening or punishing or admonishing his child is a very bad father in God's eyes. God says it is someone who is derelict. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Verse 8, "But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then you are bastards and not sons." Now, the word bastard in the English language is a very harsh word. Generally, it's uttered in a negative context when we're angry with somebody, and there's other choice words that are added into it. But it means that somebody who is born out of wedlock, that you have two people who are not married, they have a child, that child, in God's eyes, is a bastard. That even if they were to be married afterwards, there's still a curse upon that child. There's a bastard curse that goes with that. And God says, this is not how I want it. I don't want people to just live together and to have children, but I want two people to come together in a commitment because I have brought them together to love each other for life. And God blesses that union. But when we do a counterfeit to it, God does not bless that. And God is saying now that there is a distinction between bastards and sons, children who come through the way that God wants us to come, and children who do not come. And God says that when I deal with you, I don't deal with you as a bastard, someone who's illegitimate. I deal with you as someone who's my own. My own. I claim you. Verse 9. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chasten us after their own pleasure. But he, speaking of God, for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening for the present seems to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. There's kind of an overt threat there at the end. He says, make your paths straight. Choose to walk in the way that you're supposed to walk. Because if you don't, something's going to happen, he says. Now, God is portrayed by many people as simply a God of love. This does not fit with a lot of people's image of who God is. And yet here it is, it's in the Bible. This was not written today, it was not printed yesterday. I didn't make this up. Okay, it's here. The words are there. When we read the Bible, we have to make a choice. Do I believe what is written there? And if so, am I going to follow it? If there is an overt threat there, it implies that God is going to do whatever it takes to get you to be more like Jesus. Or you could say to line up with his program. However you want to term it, if you want to line up with this program, that's fine. If you want to be more like Jesus, that's fine also. It's one and the same. Now, with my children, I come and I speak to them and I say, I'd like you to do this. I speak to them. They listen, and then they have a choice to listen and obey or to listen and say, I'm going to do my own thing. Sometimes children will also opt just to refuse to even listen. But there's two things that God is looking for us. He wants us to hear his commands to us, and he wants us to follow through with obedience. If we don't do that, he will use whatever method that he deems necessary to get us to line up with his program. You look at the story of Jonah. Jonah said, I am not going to line up with this program. I do not agree with it. God used an unorthodox method to bring Jonah to Nineveh. And then God still wasn't done. Jonah still wasn't lining up with the program. And God had to do some more things with him until Jonah finally said, I yield. My children sometimes resist me to the point where it requires a little physical spanking. And then they say, I yield. But think of it this way. Are we going to listen to God when he speaks to us? Or is he going to need to swat us on the rear end? Or is he going to have to be more heavy-handed and essentially take a 2x4 and break it over your head? Now, ideally, a person who is faced with three choices, to listen and to walk in obedience, to listen and not necessarily walk in obedience and receive a light swat, or someone who just says, I'm going to do my own thing, and gets a 2x4 broken over their head. If you were to tell a person, you're going to have 3 paths to choose from, which one would you like to do? Well, they'll say, I'll take the path of least resistance, the path of no pain. Well, that's the path of love. That's the path that God wants us to go on. But if we don't choose to walk in this path of love, he has no other option but to begin more harsh measures. I don't think there's anybody that says, oh, I'm so happy in my life that God basically had to, you know, take a 2x4 and break it over my head. Unless, you know, he called us to repentance and, you know, we weren't going to go some other way. But ideally, we don't want to go that way. And living in the crucible, meaning when we're like experiencing the problems of life, did they come as a result of our actions? Did they come as a result of somebody else's actions? Did we deserve it? But no matter what the circumstances are, we can basically count on the fact that God will not abandon us. As much as Jonah disobeyed God, God never abandoned him. He may have felt abandoned, but God was there just waiting for him to say, okay, God, I yield. Flip over to Romans chapter 8. Now, I told you that God operates in love. That's how he chooses to operate. His preferred method is to come and to operate in love and peace. He never instills panic. He never instills fear. This is his counterpart, the devil. This is the devil's program. The devil's about fear, panic, and basically, you know, just hitting the panic button and saying, this is a disaster. But this isn't how God operates. It doesn't mean that just because things are, you know, basically falling around all around you, that God is not in control. I'm thinking in my head right now of when Samuel, in the Old Testament, the prophet Samuel, the Philistines had surrounded them. The Israelites had gathered together to worship God, and the Philistines said, oh, they're gathering for war. Let's go and attack them. And they surrounded them, and it just looked hopeless, and yet they basically trusted God because that's what they could do instead of panicking and hitting the panic button and running in all directions, and God brought them out of it. But again, we always can look back at these stories and we can say to ourselves, well, that's what happened. We know what happened. But in the moment, it was difficult. And right now, we're living, every one of us is living in the moment. And for what it is that we're facing, it's going to be different for all of us. Now in Romans chapter 8 and verse 35 it says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Paul lays out a bunch of scenarios here. He says, can these various things separate us? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him, that's Jesus, that loved us. For I am persuaded, Paul says. Now, what was it Paul had gone through? Paul had been beaten, stoned, experienced lots of things. A lot of persecution in his life. He said, I am persuaded, I am certain of this, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So when we're facing our problems, it's important to have that focus. We need to be able to exercise discernment to say, what's happening here around me? Now, many times we're not understanding what's happening, and we're not necessarily meant to know everything. But it's how we choose to act in that situation that's important. that's what your CQ, that's what your character quotient is all about. What is it that God is doing, and how is he forming you, growing you, building you into the person that he wants you to be? As I stated, when we look at all the examples in the Old and the New Testament, it's easy to look back and to say, oh, we see what the problem was, we saw what happened as they went through it, and we saw what the outcome was. But you take and be introspective right now and think about, you know, what is a personal struggle that you're facing with right now? Is it easy? No, it's difficult because you're living through it right now. It's very real. It's a concern. That's what being in the crucible is all about, is you're being heated, but you don't know what the outcome is going to be just yet. You're believing God for the best, but you don't know what it is. Now, authentic Christianity means that we don't have a super Christian who basically says, I'm going to power through all of this. What, how does our trials usually affect us? Negative circumstances. Well, it affects our sleep. I know that when I'm struggling with something internally, I don't sleep as well as I normally do. I sleep great every night, except when I'm wrestling with something. And then I wake up sometimes exhausted. What's another thing? Food, right? Food tastes the same all the time. It's not that the ingredients change. It's just that we lose interest. And we eat basically to survive. But we're not eating for the enjoyment of it, because there's something that keeps us preoccupied, that keeps us from enjoying whatever food that is that we're eating. And so, as we're basically struggling on a daily basis, we're trying to live our life. We're trying to live victoriously. If you go back and you read the book of Job, this guy was trying to live a victorious life. He wasn't managing to do it because Satan was just hitting him and hitting him and hitting him. And then he had friends whom, you know, realistically, somebody should have cut the lips off of these friends so they couldn't talk anymore, okay? If you had friends like that, they're not your friends. And yet he was trying to rise up through that. And he was having a really hard time doing so. And that's authentic Christianity. That's real. It's not like, you know, if you were to portray somebody in a movie who just doesn't have any problems, who can't be afflicted, who can't do anything, and they just blow through that. That would be like kind of like Superman. I mean, you can't hurt Superman. He just, you know, there's nothing you can do to him. He can't be afflicted. And he just powers through everything. But that's not real. As human beings, we're susceptible to lots of things. And when it comes to people who take us down, it's usually the people who are closest to us, family. Then it branches out to friends. You have coworkers, neighbors. Who is it that takes us down? It's the people that are close to us. Then there's also circumstances. So the trials that we have, they may be a result of poor decisions that you and I make, but it can also be through no fault of your own. You were standing next to a person who did something and it affected you as a result. But nevertheless, there is nothing that happens here on this earth that God does not allow it. So if we have the understanding that God is in control, yes, and he's going to do whatever it takes to get us to conform to the image of Christ, to that person of Jesus. But there's also things that happen here on this earth. One of the greatest arguments against Christianity and against God is they say, well, if your God is there and he's a God of love, why is there so much pain? Why is there death? Why is there suffering? Why is there rape? Why is there genocide? Why is there this, this, and this? And those are really good questions. It's a result of sin. There wasn't any of that in the Garden of Eden. Why is God allowing it to happen? Well, it fits in with his program of what he wants to happen here on this earth. Remember, there is nothing that happens on this earth that does not happen unless God allows it to happen. If he was not allowing it to happen, he would not be God and he would not be in charge. That is a difficult concept to grasp. Now, if you look to your outline, God told the human race, Genesis chapter 1, to subdue the earth. Okay, this command was repeated after the flood in Genesis chapter 9. People ignored God's command, and they decided to build a great city. Flip over to Genesis chapter 11. Now, God stood and he watched as this unfolded. And then it reached a point where God said, enough is enough. We're done with your rebellion here. We're now resuming my program once again. In Genesis chapter 11 and verse 1, it says, and the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach into heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. Now, that is what God had told them to do, spread out. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language. And this they will begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. It was in their minds, it was in their will, their free will, to do this. And God said, we're going to override this. Go to, let us go down there and confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. And so the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name called Babel, because the Lord did confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of the earth. So here we have an example of God saying, I want you to do something. He reiterates it again, I want you to do this. And they continue to not do what God has asked them to do. And so he steps in as a father now, and he says, I'm simply going to make a whole bunch of different languages. You guys are not going to be able to work together anymore because you won't be able to understand each other. And he chastened them. Now, if you are stubborn and you are trying to live in God's will and yet you're not doing everything that he wants you to do, God will allow the devil to afflict you. We have an example of this in Acts chapter 8. Now, in the Great Commission, we have Jesus instructing us to go ye therefore, right? To go out into all the earth, to share the good news of the gospel. And the early church was doing it to a certain extent, but they weren't lining up completely with God's program. So God used Saul, who later became Paul, an apostle, to basically get everybody to line up with his program. Verse 1, and Saul was consenting unto his death, this is Stephen's, and at that time there was great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. And as for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and haling or jailing men and women, committed them to prison. Verse 4, therefore they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. So now they began to do what God had initially told them to do, what Jesus had instructed them, which was to go ye therefore and preach. But they had been so happy and enjoying this Christian life, it was kind of like a honeymoon, and they got so happy that they didn't want to leave. We have an example of this in the Old Testament. We talk about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But there was a man named Terah that preceded Abraham. Terah was the one who had been called by God to come out, but he enjoyed where he was, and he stayed. And God wasn't able to break him loose. He was able to break Abraham loose, but it was difficult. So authentic Christianity is we're trying to live according to the way that God wants us to live, and yet we have our body that says, I'm comfortable right here. This is very nice. I think I'm going to stay here for a while. And God may allow that, and then he'll say, I want you to move on. No, I'm really comfortable here. This is very nice. I like it right here. And this is the example that we have here in Acts chapter 8, is that the early church got really comfortable, and God said, we're going to have to change this up. God allowed the devil to kill and imprison Christians, and many of them lost their homes. Now, if you would have gone and interviewed them, you would have seen a lot of depressed people, and they would have said, I don't know why God is allowing this to happen to us, and I don't see how any good could be coming out of this. However, when we read the rest of the book of Acts, we can see that as they scattered abroad, wherever they went, they formed new groups of believers and their new churches were born, and this is exactly what God wanted to happen. Now, God is in control, and God is in control of all the details of your life, and he will use whatever method he deems necessary to form your character quotient. He is going to mold you into that person that he wants you to be. Why? Because you're his. The Bible says that you've been bought with a price. Jesus paid a certain price for every single person that has been born again. We have been redeemed. Paul referred to himself as a bond servant. Okay? A bond servant was somebody who may have been a free man, but more than likely had been a slave who had then become free. And he voluntarily then made himself a slave again, okay? And this is to say, I will serve you, and the master would agree to provide food and lodging and clothing to meet his basic necessities. This is where we come is, you know, Jesus has bought us, we've come and we voluntarily have said, that's what happens at the moment of repentance, where we say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I am yours. And that's why the Bible says that we've been bought with a price. Now, Jesus used in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 10 here, he used an example of some sparrows to show the value that he puts in us as human beings. In verse 29, it says this, are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? You ask yourself, what's a farthing? Well, a farthing is like a quarter of a cent. That would be in our money today. A quarter of a cent. Not a whole lot of money. And I'm not sure what the value is in trying to eat a sparrow, because if you have seen a sparrow, they're not a large bird. There's people that like to eat what they call buffalo wings today. And, you know, they usually come in a large bucket or something, because you got to go through a lot of them to get something out of them. But Jesus is saying here, now he's given us an example, and he said, are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? and one of them shall not fall on the ground without your father. In other words, these insignificant little creatures, if one of them should die, you and I probably won't know about it, and we couldn't care less. But it doesn't mean that God is not aware of it, and it is important to him. And then in verse 30, but the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Jesus went on to say that, yes, these sparrows, these insignificant little birds that you see flying around all the time, and they make their little houses and stuff, and you might not consider them important, but they're important to me, God says. And you're also important to me, Jesus said, because he said, I know the precise number of hairs that you have on your head at any given moment. I don't know about you, but I've never tried to count the number of hairs that I have on my head. To me, that would be like trying to go out and count the grains of sand at the beach. This doesn't sound like a fun prospect. But what Jesus is trying to show us is that God is interested in the details of his creation, and he's interested in the details of our individual lives. And God is interested in us. And as he's forming our character and he's moving us along, he's saying, I haven't forgotten about who you are as a person. I haven't forgotten about how I designed you, the desires that I put into your life, the interest that you have, the things that you like to do. Do you realize that when you do something that you enjoy doing, God enjoys it along with you, because that's who he made you to be. He put those desires, those wants and likes and interests into your life. And when you act on them, he lives vicariously through you. He enjoys what you're doing as long as it's not sinful. So when you enjoy doing something, God enjoys it alongside you. God is not a joy killer. He's not, you know, all about rules, 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 live on these rules. There is joy. There is liberty. We have liberty. But we don't exchange that liberty for like licentiousness, where we basically go to the other extreme and we say we have the freedom to sin willfully and we can do so. That's too far. We have freedom. Within parameters, we have a lot of freedom. And a lot of people lose sight of that. When you tell people, God wants you to listen and obey, honestly, if you were to tell my children, you walk up to my children and you were to say, listen, and they could say, obey, they'll follow through with that second word. If you were to ask them, how do you feel about those words? Well, don't really like them a whole lot, just because usually, you know, it's to get me to line up with, you know, whatever my dad or my mom wants me to do. I don't really want to do that. And then they say, listen and obey. And I go, okay, the last time I didn't listen and obey, I got a spanking. So I'm going to choose to obey. God doesn't want us to obey because we're fearful of receiving punishment. He wants us to obey because we love him. God does not operate out of coercion, but out of love. His program is about love. God is also not necessarily looking to use something cute and fuzzy to form your character. He may choose to do that, okay? There's nothing wrong with having something cute and fuzzy to form your character. But the reality is that your character will be formed with negative circumstances in your life. Go back and look at the Old and New Testaments, and you can just see the truth in that. God can use cute and fuzzy, but the reality is that there will be negative things that come in your life. And he's using these things into building you into the person that he wants you to be. I wrote here, when God speaks, follow through with obedience. It's that simple. Now, having said that, the practical application of that is that we have desires. Temptation, when it comes, it overrides what God wants us to do. Paul describes in Romans, he says, there's a war within my members. He says, I know what I should be doing, but I don't do it. I know what's right and what's wrong, and I choose to do this. Paul didn't place himself up on a pedestal and say, I'm this super Christian, follow me. A lot of times we look up to him, but he was real. He was authentic, and he experienced the same types of problems that we did. And it also says in Hebrews that, you know, Jesus was tempted in all points like as we were, yet without sin. So there's nothing that you and I have gone through that Jesus didn't experience himself. And again, God is going to do whatever it takes as he molds us to be like Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Moving through the tough times. When we're living in the moment, we don't have the luxury of knowing the outcome. Okay? You look at the examples of, we read last week of King David. We touched upon Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It's also a story of Daniel in the lion's den. Just going to bring up those three. They lived in the moment, and they each faced different circumstances. And it was difficult. We also know of the stories, usually of their miraculous outcome. Now, they didn't know that a miracle was coming. They hoped. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, O king, we don't have to be careful in how we're answering you, but whether God saves us, okay, or not, our answer is still the same. But see, their speech implied that they didn't know what the outcome was going to be. That's authentic. That's real. As God builds us our character, we learn to slowly trust and obey. It's not like if you were to go back and you look at the prophet Elijah, and you were to look at his life, okay? Toward the end of his life, he was doing some pretty fantastic things. But God didn't bring him there overnight. God taught him to trust him and to follow through with obedience. Even if he didn't understand what was going on, God was looking to say, look, I've instructed you to go to this widow. Trust me. Obey. You know, and then God told him to do certain things later on. And you look at his life and you go, oh yeah, I want to be like that. But in the moment, everything was difficult for him. He didn't understand at all times everything that was happening. Think about the miracle of calling down fire from heaven. Okay? Fantastic miracle. Races back to town, outraces the king's horses. The king didn't have scrawny horses. He had, you know, expensive horses that were well-fed, that were quick. And God gave Elijah the strength to outrun the king's horses. And then Jezebel finds out what had happened to her prophets of Baal, and she says, same thing is going to happen to you like you did to my prophets. And such fear entered into him at that point that he basically said, I got to get out of here. Elijah was authentic. He was real. We look back and we see how God provided, like, you know, something happened and, you know, he went out to the desert and God provided an angel that sustained him, and then he went to the mountain, he spoke with God and he was refreshed. But the process was difficult. And we're all going through a process. The question is now, when we're going through these tough times, are they a result of us disobeying God? And if we are we going to be smart enough to say, I'm going to stop what I'm doing. I'm going to stop resisting God. Okay, it's kind of like trying to swim against a river, against the current, and I'm just going to go, turn around, and I'm going to go with God. I'm going to allow him to take me where he wants me to go. It's in our human nature to resist God. Flip over to Gospel of John, chapter 11. Now, Jesus could see into the future. He knew what was going to happen. And in the account of Lazarus, he goes away. He hears that Lazarus is sick. He purposely stays away until Lazarus has died because he knows that he's going to go back and resurrect him. And we pick up here the story now in verse 20. Gospel of John 11:20. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever you will ask of God, God will give it to you. Jesus says unto her, your brother shall rise again. Now, he knew that it was going to happen within a few minutes. Martha says unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. She's looking far into the future when she's dead. Yeah, I know he's going to rise again, Jesus. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Believe you this? She said unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, which should come of the world. Okay? She is focused now on the fact that her brother is in the grave. He has been dead for 3 days. His body is decomposing. It stinks. She is not thinking like Jesus is thinking here. These are the tough times that she's living in. Jesus then goes to the grave. And in verse 34, he says, where have you laid him? And they said, Lord, come and see. The shortest verse in the Bible is Jesus wept. Jesus didn't weep because he was sad. The scriptures explain that Jesus is weeping because they didn't understand that they had the Son of God standing in their midst and that they didn't have the faith. They didn't have the realization of what was about to happen. And he was looking at them saying, you guys are just pitiful here. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. They interpreted his tears in the wrong way. And some said, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself, comes to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. And Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto him, Lord, by this time he stinks, for he has been dead 4 days. Excuse me, 4 days, not 3 days. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto you that if you would believe, you should see the glory of God? He's telling her, you're about to see the miraculous here. And she's still not getting it. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you hear me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that you have sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound with a napkin. And Jesus said unto him, loose him, and let him go. Martha could not see God in the situation when her brother was dead. That's reality. The reality is her brother is dead. He's decomposing. That's all she could focus on. Okay? The story has a happy ending. But she couldn't see through that. That's the reality of being authentic Christianity. So, we need to ask for discernment. And if you haven't asked for discernment when it comes to a particular situation, if you're not asking God to reveal why it's happening and the way that he wants you to get out of it, why are you not asking him? We see here from the example of Martha that Jesus is trying to, without coming out and saying, hey, Martha, I'm going to go raise your brother from the dead. She goes, well, yeah, I know you're going to raise him from the dead in the future, but, you know, it'd be nice if he was alive right now. And she just wasn't understanding that that was what Jesus was about to do. It can be, you know, that you have a difficult circumstance, you have a life-threatening situation, you have whatever it is. What does God want you to do? If God is in control of everything that happens, would it not be prudent, therefore, to ask him, since we've been bought with a price, what is it that you want me to do in this situation? And then to wait for an answer. We shouldn't be like Abraham when he said, God, you promised me a child. I'm going to take matters into my own hands. And he sleeps with Hagar, produces a child, Ishmael, and Ishmael's descendants would go on to be a thorn in Israel's side, and still to this day. That was not what God wanted Abraham to do. Abraham should have waited, listened and waited. Now, God was slow in answering him, but God would have answered. We can see from looking back that God did answer. So God's program is happening. I wrote this on the outline. Make your peace with it, because it's happening whether you like it or not. Okay? As God is developing your character quotient, as he's developing who you are and who he wants you to be in the kingdom of God, he has a program that's unfolding all around us. We're just a player, if you will, on a field. We've been placed here at this time and at this place. And the question is, what are we going to do? Jesus has promised us to not leave us, to not forsake us. We have scriptural promises. You find that in John 14, 18. And you also find in John chapter 15 where Jesus says that he is the vine, we are the branches. He wants us to be connected to him. And when we're connected to him, we will bear fruit. And we will work together, and it will be a cohesive team working together, not, you know, trying to be your own person and separate yourself from God. As we're growing in godly character, and there are times where we're going to be in that crucible where it's hot and it simply seems unbearable, know that you're there because God has allowed that to happen. And what you choose to do next is entirely up to you, but you have a choice to go with God or to do your own program. It doesn't mean that God's program is always going to be easy. But when you finish your time here on this earth, you will be the person that God wants you to be. That boy that was retarded, who understood the gospel and he said, God loves me, okay, could be far greater in the kingdom of God than any one of us, despite his retardation, because he's growing in godly character. God does not care how intelligent you are, how much money you have, how good looking you are. He's interested in our character as we progress through life. And that's why we have this saying here at the end of every single outline. It's not how you begin your life after salvation, but how you finish your life. We need to finish well, and we need to finish strong. So if you're listening to this and you're saying, I'm not living the way that God wants me to live, you have a choice. You have the ability to change your life. You can be different. You can have a life of victory. You can have what you're not having if you're going against God right now. But the choice is yours. And that's what it comes down to. It's free will. God is not going to just tell you, this is a cookie cutter, and you're going to be like this, this, and this, and this. We're all different. And true love is where we choose to come to God, okay, and we say, God, use me. No matter where you are in your life, and God will honor that. Brother Thomas, will you close us in prayer?
Father God, thank you for the word, Lord. And we know that it is the ultimate struggle for the Christian. It is to line up with the will of God. So we ask that you would help each and every one of us to line up, Lord, and to be able to come against our own resistance, or the resistance of the flesh, Lord. And we thank you for strengthening each one of us to be strong players on the field, Lord. And we just thank you for giving us a vision also, Lord, of our future. We know that you do that, that you will give us a vision as to where we're to go and what we're to do. And we thank you for that. Thank you for strengthening us. We need the strength, Lord, physically, spiritually, emotionally. We're asked for your strength upon us. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that You would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in You. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that You paid for my sins on the cross through Your shed blood, and that You died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank You for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with You. Help me to be obedient and to walk with You In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Thorell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Been listening to the weekly webcast. This message was entitled Living in the Crucible. Life is not fun when you're in the midst of a crisis. Trials may result from poor decisions or through no fault of your own. Nevertheless, there is nothing that happens unless God allows it. The Lord is interested in developing your character quotient, and there is a refining process that comes with growing in Christ. God is in charge of all the details of your life, and will use whatever method He deems necessary to form your character. Instead of something cute and fuzzy, more than likely the Lord will use negative circumstances to build your faith and form you into the person He wants you to be. Often you don't have the luxury of knowing the outcome when you're in the midst of a struggle, and without discernment, you're just fumbling around, blindly trying to fix a bad situation. Why is God allowing it to happen? What lesson is He trying to teach you? These are important questions. Are you inadvertently resisting the Lord? There are numerous men in the Bible who realized it was futile to resist God. Instead, allow the Lord to lead you. It won't always be easy, but if you follow Jesus, you will grow in godly character and be successful in the kingdom of God. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1498. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.